Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
Church, you become the church. But the church isn't the building. The church is the vision. The church is the people. The church is the gathering. It doesn't matter if we have stained glass or not. We're not looking for religious symbolism. We're looking for spiritual substance that's found only in Christ Jesus. The substance is that we're giving a place for a gathering for His presence to come and connect with real people with real problems and situations on a real journey that just have a sincere heart to move along and get to know God better. That's what church life is about. We are Now Church, building a relevant, creative church, empowering people to reach others. Not just empowered for yourself, but empowered to go love somebody that was unlovable. Thousands of people have come onto this property, into this auditorium, and have experienced a life-changing touch from God. But we believe that our best days are still ahead of us, not behind us. In order to keep doing that, you know, you can't rest on what you've accomplished. Why are we still looking for the best days? Because we're not enthralled with our past as much as we are captivated by our future. Now Church has never been stronger, more focused, more united around our common mission, vision, and values. By God's grace, we are healthy, and we're poised for the future.
Good morning, everybody. Could you put your hands together for Jesus if you're happy you came to church today? We're going to be talking about the finished work of our God. It's already been accomplished on the cross, yeah.
Everything that I've ever needed. I'm resting in a finished
work. All right, so church, here's the good news. Everything that you need, freedom, healing, victory, it's already been done on the cross. Is anybody glad about that this morning? Let me hear you. That was all right. Do me a favor. Put your hands together like this. The work is finished. Say,
the work is finished.
Thank you. Resurrection Sunday, everybody. Come on, that's a lot to celebrate. And we're glad that you're here. We're glad that you're watching online. Welcome everybody that's watching us on our online campus. Listen, we've got a lot to celebrate. Of course, this is Resurrection Sunday. Some people call it Easter Sunday. Either way, you know what it is all about? It is all about that moment. That moment in time when all of history shifted. That moment in time where everything changed from hopelessness, from a destination of death to life. Isn't that powerful? And here's the thing. Jesus and all of this stuff, I think one of the most powerful things that he corrected one day when people were talking about, yeah, everything's going to be all right, you know, come the resurrection day, the day that there is resurrection. He said, no, you don't understand. I am the resurrection and I am the life. He's saying, I'm the vehicle. I'm the one that brought it about. Jesus is the one that we celebrate today. Come on, let's give Jesus a hand clap today. Because he is resurrection. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. And so we want to celebrate that. And I don't know about you, but I'm thinking that all of this world and all the crazy chaos and everything that is happening around the world, even in your neighborhood, we're needing to see a whole lot of resurrection taking place, right? Maybe you come today and you're looking for that moment where you're looking for resurrection, something to shift, something to come from death to life. Let's believe God that Jesus, he answers it all, right? Let's pray right now and join with me today as we pray for our whole city, for we pray for other churches, we pray for this resurrection day. Lord, we thank you for all that this means. Father, we come in to your throne room boldly by the blood of Jesus that you shed on the cross. That's resurrection. Lord, you resurrected our relationship and our connection. We can come to you. And Lord, we ask you for resurrection power on our nation. Resurrection power, Lord, in the nations of the world today as we're celebrating, Lord, your life, your strength. Lord, we thank you for your joy to bring about a resurrection in each person's life, Lord, that we would see hope, that we would see hope for the future, that we would see hope that you are for us and not against us. And Lord, we give you praise today. And Lord, we pray, Lord, your strength as this word is delivered through your churches around the nations of the world, even in our neighborhood. Father, we pray strength today of your churches. Resurrect your churches in every area and every nation in Jesus' name. And we give you praise today. Amen. Come on, let's celebrate him really big. Listen, we're so glad you're here. We've got so much happening here in the room. We've got a ton of stuff happening outside with the kids today. So with all of this stuff happening, maybe you're new and maybe this is the first time you've come by. We want to make sure you feel welcome and go by our Welcome Center if you haven't. Between services, stop by there. They have a gift for you because we want to welcome you and just make sure you know that we are so happy that you're here. Look, we have been working quite a bit preparing for you. We feel like hosts that you've come over to our house, and we hope that you enjoy your time with us today. We believe you will. Also, we want to throw out something. Every week we throw out a challenge. Every single week we throw out a challenge. It's called 3-Week Challenge. We say, check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. We love to throw that challenge out because we know that God will meet you if you decided to give him a little room to speak into your life. I'm telling you, he's just going to blow you away. All right? So let's continue to worship right now. Come on, let's give God some praise.
Oh, we love Jesus in this room. Lord, we bless you and we thank you that you are faithful to us in every way. And if you're new to the house or if you've been here many times, I ask him to do this a lot. Would you lift up your hands all over the building? I don't even say if you're comfortable. If you can, just do it. Lift your hands up to the King of Kings. And just know that that is a position and a posture of surrender. And you're just saying, God, I'm open to whatever you want to do in me today. So, Lord, you see these people. You see them in the room. You see them at home. You see where they are, what their needs are. But, God, we know that you exchange our burdens for your joy. You take our sorrows and you exchange it for the fullness of your grace and your love. So our hands are lifted high to say this with me. Say, Jesus, thank you for the sacrifice you made for me. I receive now everything you have, everything that's available. I reach out to receive from you today. Now, in this house, we love to worship him. So before we put lyrics on a screen, I want you to do me a favor and lift your voices loud enough so your ears can hear. Come on. Come on, lift your worship. Loud enough for your ears to hear. It's just you and Jesus. We encourage you right now. We worship you, Lord. Yeah. Be exalted, be glorified, be magnified. Yeah. You are welcome here. You are welcome. Yeah, yeah, yeah. And maybe this is your story. Are you hurting, broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Sing it.
Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. That's the good news today.
I would even
Come on, lift your voices all over the room. Oh, I worship you, Jesus. I've built my life on you, God. Yeah. Sing it with us if you know it. Sing, rain came, rain came. Now say rain. It always reminds me that nothing matters but the presence of God. Can you hear me? Do y'all know what I'm talking about? I mean, rain comes, winds blow, sound goes crazy, but guess what? I'm gonna make it through. Are you gonna make it through today? I don't mind these moments, because in His presence is the fullness of joy. So for the last time, I'm gonna ask you to lift up your hands. I'm gonna ask you to lift them high. And I'm gonna ask you to sing with your heart, without distraction, with all the stuff that goes on. Just say, see, rain came when blue, my house was built on you. Singing, I'm saved, say, I'm saved. Yeah. I love this on Easter Sunday. Singing, last time, say, rain came. I wonder if you could put your hands together. I mean, for real, for real, for real.
Come on and worship Him. Yeah. Let's praise the Lord. Come on and praise Him. He's alive. He's mighty. I thought for a minute that the praise and worship was so hot that the fire alarms went off. I didn't know what happened. I still don't know what happened, but you're only about 20 feet, 30 feet from a door, so we should be okay. Everything's fine. They just said they just had to reset it, just a false alarm. Yeah. This wasn't the sound. You got your ears on and you can't hear the normal. Anyway, there he goes. Yeah. Amen. That's what it is about. Anyway, it is a great moment. We're glad that you're here. Would you turn around and greet some people around you and tell them it's going to be a great day? You can go and be seated. We're going to receive our tithes and offerings right now really quickly. One of our core values here at Now Church is generosity. And listen, for those of you that are first-time guests, we're not asking you for anything. Please, we're never going to have somebody over to our house and then hit you with the Publix receipt at the end of the meal, okay? So we're not asking you for anything. We didn't bring you here for money. We brought you here because we want you to give your heart to the Lord. I want you to open yourself up to Him. That's where it all begins, amen? So ushers are going through right now. If any of our people want to give and want to be part of this, we have our envelopes that are available for you for cash and check giving and our I Gave cards for electronic giving. And we're going to pray right now. Listen, one of the things we are so thankful for, I want to say a huge thank you to our Now Church members and people that support here. We've been able to go to do almost the impossible. We're participating with a pastor friend of ours in Poland to help the Ukrainian refugees. And we've been able to, in the last few weeks, without anything in the budget to do it, we were able to give over $12,000 to Ukrainian relief. And that is a tribute to your generosity, your giving. So thank you for that. I want to say a huge thank you. I talked to Pastor Zibby this week. He's now up to 5 hotels. Remember, he said he was going to get 4? They got 5. They now have 800 refugees. When he was with us 2.5 weeks ago, they had 400 or 450. Now they're up to 800, and they're going to 1,000 refugees taken care of in Poland. We're able to be part of that. So thank you for your giving. Let's pray right now. Father, thank you that you love the world so much that you gave your best gift. And we worship you today with our best gift. Thank you for blessing each person. Lord, would you fight for the people in Ukraine right now that are all over Europe and all over the world? Would you help them, Lord? Would you restore their home? We pray for peace in Ukraine. And we pray that you restore that nation. And Lord, we need revival right here in America. Lord, do a work here in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you for your giving.
Cool. One of the greatest joys of my life is being a part of this worship team. How many of you appreciate this band and singers over here? Would you give them a hand, and maybe your first time?
Look at me now. Look how you Well, thanks for bearing with us during our construction time out here. By this time next year, we hope to be in a brand new building. Not just, it's not even an auditorium. It's not about a sanctuary. We're building a new multi-purpose building for the kids, mainly for kids' classrooms and for lobby space. Be a nice cafe over there. So anyway, we hope to do it up better for you next year, but we hope that you'll be back before then, okay? Anyway, we're going to get right into the thought for today. I had this thought come to me a few weeks ago, and I presented it to our team. I call it crime scene investigation. Has anybody noticed how obsessed our culture has become with murder mysteries? It's crazy. I mean, I remember as a kid in the innocent times playing the Clue game. You know, Miss Scarlet usually did the, you know, killed the victim in the conservatory with a lead pipe for some reason, but the old-fashioned whodunit, the Agatha Christie mysteries and the Poirot, you know, murder on the Orient Express, all these things were around, but it's come a long way from Perry Mason or Matlock and Law and Order or all the CSI TV shows. They probably got CSI Bellevue by now, I think. But it's almost like something shifted to me when I started thinking about it. It's like something shifted during the O.J. Simpson trial in the 1990s. Dateline stopped being an NBC ripoff of 60 Minutes as simply a news magazine program and became nonstop murder mysteries. Podcasts today. All the TV subscription services. Netflix has them. Hulu's got them. Apple TV Plus, Minus, etc. has got them. Everything. But realizing this made me wonder about the ultimate homicide of human history. Because as a kid, I'll be honest with you, I grew up in church, but I didn't really understand why Jesus died. I didn't understand the whole process. I didn't understand the crucifixion, the whole suffering. And the question of my heart as a kid was, who killed Jesus of Nazareth? Who killed him? So I want to look at the crime scene for a few moments today. In the truest account of the crime of Calvary, it's not what all history has written. It's what the Bible clearly lays out as the truth of God's word, as a list of possible suspects. So I've got a few suspects I want to look at with you today, and we're going to hopefully answer this question: who killed Jesus and why did he die? First suspect, most of us I think would blame pretty quickly, is Judas Iscariot. Judas Iscariot, one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, he was the treasurer of the group. He was the money guy. He was apparently good with numbers. He was so good that he was actually extorting money and cash from the ministry till under a heavy cloak of religious piety. He was secretly greedy for money, but he hid there with Jesus and was right there among the 12. When a woman broke open a priceless jar of oil a week before Jesus went to the cross, Jesus dealt with Judas because this attitude came up, and this woman went to express her love and thanks to Jesus, and Judas had a public fit, calling it a waste of money that could have been used for the poor, but he was going to steal from it anyway. That's why he was upset. Jesus called him out and apparently embarrassed Judas, hurting his pride. From that moment, the devil began to fill his heart with offense, resentment, and betrayal. Eventually, with a kiss of betrayal, Judas sold out Jesus for a price, 30 pieces of silver. He wound up not doing any time or anything else for his crime against God and man, but he actually took his own life because he felt so guilty for what he'd done. Was it Judas? Or maybe our second suspect was a group of suspects, the Roman soldiers. I mean, we have all kinds of evidence from the Word of God what they did. I mean, from the arrest of Jesus in the garden, these soldiers were beating Jesus with their hands, with their fists. They were slapping him. They were mocking him. They were whipping him with whips that had steel hooks on them that would rip open the flesh on his back and make him unrecognizable as a human being. They sarcastically crowned him with thorns, and they spit in his face again and literally nailed his hands and feet to filthy pieces of wood in the shape of a cross. If that wasn't enough, as they continued their jeers, they gambled for his kingly purple robe and eventually thrust a spear into his side to make sure he was dead as blood and water spilled out. Oh, they definitely participated in the crime, but did they alone murder Jesus? Or was it our third suspect, Caiaphas? Caiaphas was a Jewish high priest that year. He and his father-in-law, Annas, a previous high priest, were concerned that if Jesus were to continue on with his miracles and healings, that the Roman government might think it's a terroristic plot and forcibly destroy Jerusalem to stop him. So they made a political calculation, like so many politicians today. Caiaphas stated that he would be more to the people's advantage if, quote, one man died in the place of all. He didn't know what he said, but he gave a prophetic thought about what Jesus would do for all of the world. Caiaphas was a coward, would not even take responsibility. In fact, he cloaked it in legalisms and decided to play ping pong by sending Jesus back and forth with the Roman governor, who's our fourth suspect, Pontius Pilate. Pontius Pilate was the fifth governor of the Roman province of Judea. Now, you might think this is silly, but as a kid, as a church kid growing up, I thought the word pilot was like the pilot that flies your plane. I kept picturing, you know, this is your captain speaking, Captain Pontius here, I'm your pilot. Thank you for that underwhelming response. It was just a childhood thought, but part of his deal was that he refused. Listen, his wife had a dream. And in this dream, God told her, tell your husband that Jesus is innocent. Let him go. And she told her husband, but Pontius Pilate wouldn't even listen to his wife. Now that's, you better watch that one, guys. Because that's a tough one right there, okay? Doesn't make him a murderer, but it does make him a fool. And all the women said, amen. Thank you. He did eventually proclaim Jesus to be innocent, but then he asked the crowd, thinking they would certainly choose between Jesus and a known insurrectionist and convicted murderer named Barabbas. There was this custom that during the Passover, the Roman governor would pardon one prisoner. And they put Jesus, he thought, well, certainly they'll pick Jesus. And as usual, even to this day, the agitators in the crowd convinced the people and stirred up the crowd to call for Jesus to be crucified and Barabbas to be released, even though he was a murderer. Even as he decided to please the people, pardon me, Pilate publicly washed his hands in the presence of all. And the Bible says he claimed his innocence and said, I am innocent of this man's blood. Typical politician, always trying to cover up the plot to the shameful decisions and pivot to something that looks better. Which leads me to our fifth suspect. You may have heard of him, another disciple of Jesus named Simon Peter. Now, though he didn't betray Jesus in the same way, he did betray him to the depths of something, especially being a leader. This guy, Simon Peter, was a fisherman. He had a tendency to speak before he actually thought things through. And he started as this fisherman, but in this process, Peter pledged his life and his loyalty to Jesus only the night before. At the Last Supper, Peter swore, I'm with you. I'll never betray you. I'll never back away from you. But after Jesus' arrest, Peter opened his foul mouth and swore repeatedly that he didn't even know the Lord to try to get away and get out of trouble. He went up back in Galilee, running back to his past, the familiar life and failure he'd experienced. Miraculously, Peter was restored and became chief spokesman of the early church. Our sixth suspect is certainly involved. Satan himself, the serpent, the devil, the deceiver, the accuser. The problem is this: there was an old school comedian when I was growing up named Flip Wilson, whose tagline was, "The devil made me do it." And it sounded real popular. We go, yeah, just blame the devil. Just blame the devil. But I'm telling you, God uses people, so does the enemy. And the enemy of your soul would love to get in there and bring all kinds of accusation and deception. Certainly wherever death and destruction exists, the devil is certainly involved somewhere. But we can't just blame him alone for this injustice against Jesus. Finally, the final suspect, the people. The people of that day, maybe. The crowds are whipped up into a dangerous mob frenzy by the religious agitators crying out, "Crucify him, crucify him." Certainly, they were involved somehow. And what about these mystery people in our file? Who are they? See, here's the truth that I didn't know till I was 19, even being raised in church all my life. The truth is, the mystery people that killed Jesus is us. You and me. You might argue, as I did as a young man, "Well, I've never murdered anybody. I wasn't even born yet. I didn't consent to the killing of Jesus." And while you may be technically correct, the Word of God says that if you're guilty of one sin, you're guilty of all sin. The fact is, we each stand in our own humanity as sinners guilty before God. Born into a fallen world. Romans 3:23 in the scripture said this: "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." Now, like most people in America, even Christians, as a young man, I used to believe that I was a really good person. Even though I had junk in my life like anybody did, I compared myself with other people. And I never compared myself with the standard of God. And I used to believe that I was automatically a Christian because I went to church and I did more good things than I did bad things. And I was trying, after all. I have good intentions. But think about it. Everyone has lied at some point, even if it's just to be nice. Cheated, entertained evil thoughts. We were all born into a fallen world with a sinful nature, and therefore have participated in some way in the conspiracy to kill Jesus. I was taught in Bible school years ago that there are sins of commission, things you do that make you guilty. But for those who lived as close to the line as they could and lived almost a perfect life, there are sins of omission. Things that God said he wanted you to do that you didn't do. Equally, finding yourself falling short. But here's the great news. Once you realize you're lost, and I might add, only then, only once you realize you're lost can you become truly found. We call it being born again. My friends, the only people who get saved are those who acknowledge their need for a Savior. Now, in case you hadn't noticed the last couple of years, because a lot of people have said, "Well, salvation, saving, what are we saved from?" There's a whole lot going on we need salvation from right now. The only people who get saved are those who acknowledge their need for a Savior. One man said, "Sin is simply loving things and using people instead of loving people and using things." And aren't we all guilty there sometimes? Jesus didn't die on an excruciating cross to condemn you or me, even though we're guilty. He did it to become our substitute and to take all the punishment that we deserved upon himself. God's holiness demands justice, and justice demands punishment. Jesus took our punishment. Romans 3:25 said this way, God sacrificed Jesus on the altar of the world to clear that world of sin. Having faith in him sets us in the clear. God decided on this course of action in full view of the public to set the world in the clear with himself through the sacrifice of Jesus, finally taking care of the sins that he had so patiently endured. And the best news of all, Easter is about resurrection power. You see, my friend, it's not about just the story of Jesus' death and murder on the cross. He didn't stay in the grave, as we've been singing about. Easter is about resurrection power. He descended into hell itself and took back the keys of death and hell and torment and rose from the dead. And now Jesus is alive. And he's here. Pardon me. And the best news of all, his grace and mercy are moving in this room right now.
Mercy is falling, yeah. Lift up your head, receive it now.
What a God we have, and how fortunate we are to have him, this Father of our Master Jesus. Because Jesus was raised from the dead, we've been given a brand new life and everything to live for, including a future in heaven, and the future starts now. My friends, there's only one man who loved you enough to die for you, only one name that can save you from the depravity of this crazy world we live in. Acts 4 says, nor is there salvation in any other, for there's no other name given among men by which we must be saved, but by the name of Jesus. I want to pray for you before we go. We'll be out there in a few minutes and be able to see the kids finishing up a great time. But you can have a great time on Easter Sunday and still be lost and still stay broken because you wouldn't do one thing. Receive a free gift. The free gift of salvation is just that. Jesus paid the price and then gives you the opportunity to know him in a real way, to be cleansed, to be forgiven. But like any gift, if you let it fall on the ground, nothing's going to happen. With this gift, as in any other, you have to take it and receive it unto yourself and open it up and see what's inside. That's what church life is about. We want to help you to grow in making that decision. Sometimes the hardest thing to do is simply admit when you've been wrong, when you've blown it, when you've messed up. Would you bow your head and close your eyes just for another moment as we pray? Father God, would you show forth your resurrection power today? In this place, we believe for the greatest miracle to happen, greater than healing from cancer, greater than being set free from demonic power. The greatest miracle is that someone can come into a place dead on the inside, dead in their sin, broken and lost. And yet, through prayer, access the very throne of grace and that presence of God, that mercy that's falling right now. Holy Spirit, would you reveal yourself to everyone in this place, everyone in this room, everyone connecting with us in our online campus right now. Would you let the Lord deal with your heart right now, wherever you are? Nobody has lived a perfect life. Nobody has been good enough in their own righteousness to earn the way to God, except for Jesus himself. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, just for a moment, maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I need God in my life. I want this. Maybe you're here and you knew the Lord at one point, but life happened and you got sidetracked and you fell away. This is your moment to come home, prodigal. This is your moment to come home. This is your moment to acknowledge him and your need for Jesus, not as a one-time prayer, but as a one-time beginning of a relationship that continues on and on and on. If you're here today and you say, Pastor, would you pray for me? All I want you to do is one thing. I'm not going to embarrass anybody here, but right now, wherever you are watching us or in this room or somewhere in this building, I want you to, if you say, I want to be in on that prayer, I need God in my life, I really see it now. I understand something I didn't know before. If that's you, would you do something right now by faith? Would you put your hand up in the air and say, I need God in my life. I want to know Jesus. Put your hand up in the air and keep it up. Put your hand up in the air and keep it up. This is the moment where some people say to me after church, I wish I'd have done something, Pastor. It was for me. I felt something, but I didn't do anything. Right now, this is your moment. I want to pray for you. Father, would you minister to every person whose hand is raised, every person whose heart is open, and bring that shift that they need. Bring that change. Reveal Jesus to them, to us, and through them, and through us to others. If you had your hand up right there, would you pray this with me out loud, just right where you're seated? Just say, Jesus. Everybody in the church, pray with them that you want to pray. No, pray with them. Pray out loud with them. Just say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Come into my life.
Come into my life.
I need your mercy.
I need your mercy.
I have messed up.
I have messed up.
I didn't know.
I didn't know.
That I was in.
I was in.
So much trouble.
So much trouble.
But I realize now.
I realize now.
that I need you. Come into my heart. Forgive my sin. And change me from the inside out. I want to be born again. I want a fresh start. I want to start new today. And I give you my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you meant that prayer, God is going to meet you right where you are and touch your life. We want to help you to grow. In a few weeks, we're going to have a water baptism service here, probably on a Wednesday night. We'll set that date. You can watch us online. You can look at our website and find out when that's going to be. But we'd love for you to be here. Take our three-week challenge. Come the next couple weeks. We got a lot happening around here. We want to help you grow. If you prayed that prayer today, let somebody know. The Bible says you have to confess it. You have to tell somebody to make it genuine, to make it real. You just need to say to somebody, I prayed. I prayed with that pastor a few minutes ago. If you'll do that, that begins to connect that whole thought that happened. It begins to take root in your heart in a brand new way. We love you so much. And we're so glad that you're here. Would you put your hands together for Jesus, the Savior of the world, for he's risen. He's risen indeed. Come on and praise him.
All right. As you said, we're so glad that you're here. And if you don't know, if you haven't been around this church and know our schedule, on Wednesday nights, we also have a service just to encourage you and just help to build your faith. That happens at 7 p.m. on Wednesdays. We'd love for you to come and join us. This week, we're going to be hearing from Pastor Gail. And so she always brings a great word, inspiring and encouraging. So it's really going to be good. And then also this next Sunday, for those of you that are parents or grandparents, we have something special we're calling Parents Connect. It's an opportunity to gather together. We're going to be getting together at 5 o'clock. And it's going to be a time where we're gathered together and really help you as parents. In this season, it's a very wild, challenging time to raise kids to know Jesus in a wholesome environment. We want to help you in every way we can to just come alongside you and encourage you that way and really gain some really good wisdom and insight on how to raise children in this culture, in this season. So again, that's 5 o'clock. We're going to have some snacks and things provided for your kids and childcare, and it's a free event, 5 o'clock to six, a little after six. So love to have you here for that. Go ahead and stand up. And listen, we're so excited to have you. Happy Resurrection Day. We love you. Let's go and enjoy our time. Enjoy a time out there with the kids, too.
I'm not afraid to
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag #NowChurch. Thank you.